Hello everyone, I'm Irene Tuffrey-Wijne and I'm honoured to welcome you to this first webinar in the new webinar series of the PCPLD Network. We were just completely overwhelmed by the interest in the webinar we had in September, which has been watched by more than 2,500 of you. And I think that just completely blows my mind. You know, how amazing that there's so many of you out there who want to think about end-of-life care for people with learning disabilities and wanting to make sure we do it better. So very many of you have asked us for more webinars, so here we are. We are going to host these every second Tuesday lunchtime of the month. And to start things off, we have a topic that I get so many questions about, especially from healthcare staff and medical teams who are perhaps less familiar with supporting people with learning disabilities. And the question is, how do you assess the needs of people whose communication is difficult to understand and who may not use words? So here are our speakers for today, and between them, they will speak for about half an hour. And after their talks, they will be here to answer your questions. So do you use the Q&A box to ask them anything you'd like to hear more about? We've got Claud and Dorothy live, and we're also trying to connect with Amanda. I hope that's going to work. We're also live tweeting this webinar. So if you are on Twitter, do join the conversation using the hashtag PCPLD2020. And as before, we will conclude this webinar on a musical note. So I do hope you can stay with us for the full hour. I promise you, you'll be uplifted. And the webinar will be recorded. It's going to be available on YouTube. And at the end of the webinar, I will give you details on how you can obtain a certificate of attendance. But now, without further ado, let's just listen to what our speakers have to say. So first of all, we're going to listen to Amanda Cresswell.
My name is Amanda Cresswell, and I'm going to tell you my story about me having cancer. I knew that there is something wrong, very wrong with me, because my hair is always greasy. Every time I went up and down the stairs, I was shortness of breath, and I went to see my doctor. And he said, there's nothing wrong with me, but I knew there was something seriously wrong.
And Amanda, you know, when you went to the doctor, because he said your hair was always greasy and you were getting out of breath, and you thought that, well, this is not normal. Yeah, you must have thought this is not my, I'm not my usual self.
No, I definitely didn't feel my usual self, because I lost my appetite as well. I didn't feel hungry.
So you went to the doctor because you thought something is wrong. What yeah. did you tell the doctor? Can you remember what you told him?
I told him that about my hair, that I had no appetite, that every time I went up and down the stairs, I found it difficult to breathe, but he just did not believe me. He said, oh, here she comes again, or something like this. But he could have done something, because if he sent me for an x-ray sooner rather than me collapse, then I could have got the treatment sooner rather than later.
So I'm quite shocked to hear, actually, Amanda, that your doctor didn't believe you when you said, you know, I'm getting short of breath, I can't, you know, I can't get up and down the stairs. That's quite a difference from your usual self. So why do you think your doctor didn't believe you?
I don't know why he didn't believe me. He just did not believe me at all. And I know when there's something wrong and when I don't feel very well.
So how did that make you feel, Amanda, when the doctor said, oh, don't worry, there's nothing wrong with you?
I felt very, very down and upset, because before I got my diagnosis, everybody thought I was depressed and had mental health problems. Because that's what I felt. I didn't feel like going to do my voluntary work. I just didn't feel like doing anything.
So you felt unwell, physically unwell in your body. The doctor said there's nothing wrong with you, and everybody else around you thought that you were depressed.
Yeah.
And what did you think then at the time? Did you think, well, there must be nothing wrong with me, or?
No, I was really worried because of doing a billion seconds, I knew I had a funny feeling there must be something really wrong.
So what did you do next, Amanda, when the doctor sent you home saying nothing's wrong with you, don't worry?
I wish I had got in a taxi and gone straight to the hospital. I should have done that, not go back to my carers. Instead of me going to stay with my family because they thought, oh, the sea air would do me good. But even Alan didn't believe me. My cousins did. Hannah even wanted to take me to the hospital in Bournemouth. But Alan kept saying, oh, there's nothing wrong. And even my nan at the time, she thought there was something wrong because they had a big house, they got a big house in Bournemouth. And I could hardly get up those stairs. But it wasn't until I actually got home and then collapsed that something was done.
So you went home, so, and you went to stay with your family, and actually things were only done when you actually really collapsed, like in a heap on the floor, or what happened?
Yeah, definitely, because I went back to my carers and I opened the door and I just collapsed through the door. I don't know how I got home. I just don't know how I had the energy, because when I got to Waterloo, they wanted to call an ambulance. But I said no, because I didn't know where I would end up.
And when you got to the ambulance, so you collapsed, you got to the hospital.
Yeah.
And then what did they find in the hospital?
And then they did tests, but they wasn't 100% sure what was wrong with me. It wasn't until this one doctor said, I'm transferring you to Charing Cross. And if it hadn't been for Dr. Lewinsky, I know 100% I would be sitting here now talking to you. Because he took me under his wing and he found out what was wrong and he gave me the right chemotherapy. And luckily it shrunk my tumour.
I'm thinking still of that first of your GP, or you know, your family doctor. Did you go on your own when you went to him, or did you have somebody with you to help you explain?
The first time I went by myself, and then the second time, the person Rose Case, who was in charge of the scheme that I was on, she came with me, and she got the same answers. There's still nothing wrong. And then maybe that's when she should have taken me straight to the hospital, I think, not took me home. I think that would have been better.
Did she believe you?
Yes, she did. She did believe me.
But she wasn't able to say to the doctor then, hang on a minute, Mr. Doctor.
She tried, but he still wasn't listening.
And I'm going to ask you a bit more, because I've never heard that bit of the story before, Amanda, that your friends and family thought that maybe you were depressed.
That's what they thought. I should have told you a lot before.
That's okay. But what made them think that?
Mm, because I was always low, I was crying. I did it even like so many times. I got the phone call to go to St. George's and I just didn't have the energy to go to St. George's. And maybe when Sheila phoned me to ask me to do the doctors, maybe I should have told her how I was feeling at the time. And maybe she would have been able to get help sooner. Or I should have spoken to you. That's what I should have done.
You know, I don't think I knew you yet then, Amanda. I think that we've known each other a long time, but I think this is before I met you, because this is a long time ago, isn't it? It's about 15 years ago or so.
It's gone so quick. Do you want me to move the pumpkin out of the way? Can you see the pumpkin?
I can't see any pumpkin. No, this is absolutely perfect, Amanda. This, you look really nice and I can hear you clearly. That's really good.
Thank you, Amanda, for telling us that story. It's so important for us to hear it. So thank you for sharing that with us. It doesn't really need saying how important it is that medical teams listen to what people with learning disabilities and their families have to say. And of course, you know, the distressing part of Amanda's story for me is that she did say and she wasn't listened to. But what also strikes me is that when she became, you know, low in mood and you know, maybe not doing the things she used to be able to do, it was sort of misinterpreted as depression. So how difficult really is it to assess symptoms correctly and to interpret them correctly for people who don't even have the language, who can't communicate in words like Amanda could. So I'm so happy to be able to welcome Claud Regnard, Dorothy Matthews and Lynn Gibson, who I came across about 20 years ago when I first started work in this area of end-of-life care for people with a learning disability. And they had just developed the DisDAT tool, which was a tool to help staff to identify and understand the signs of distress in people with severe communication problems. They will tell you all about this. They have kept developing this tool. I think it's absolutely brilliant. And so I'm going to hand over straight to them and they will introduce themselves.
Hello, my name is Claud Regnard. I'm a doctor who works in the specialty of palliative care and I'm an honorary consultant at St Oswald's Hospice in Newcastle upon Tyne. We want to talk today about trying to understand the language of distress. When people are distressed, they can usually tell us exactly what's wrong, but some people in some situations find it difficult or impossible to let us know what is going on. And when that happens, how can we tell if they're distressed and how can we find out if it's pain or discomfort, fear, anger or depression? Now, one issue we need to make clear is that the issue lies with us, the carers. Sometimes we find it difficult to find the right words to explain what is happening to an individual, but sometimes we find it difficult to understand an individual's language of distress. Now, many people are able to say or make clear that they're distressed and to explain what is causing this, even if it's only pointing at the area that's causing the problem. But some can struggle to explain what's wrong when they're ill or very ill, or they find it difficult to explain what's wrong even when they're well. Now, as carers, we don't always recognize a person's distress, especially if we don't know them. And to add to the problem about how someone shows their distress, we don't always share that information with others. So how do people communicate distress without using words? Well, all of us give out lots of signs and behaviours that show how we're feeling. So John here has some bad tummy pain. He may be able to use words, or the way he speaks might change by changing the volume, the pitch, or using sounds rather than words. His face can tell us a lot by his expression or the way he moves his eyes, his jaw, his tongue. His body will also be giving us lots of cues, such as his skin temperature, the colour of the skin, his posture, his breathing, whether he's eating more or less, his activity and his behaviour. Now, how good are carers at picking up distress? Well, you know, if they know the individual, they can be very good. The issue is that they do it instinctively, almost without thinking. And that means they don't always have the confidence in what they're observing. And that can make it difficult to explain what they're observing to other carers. So what do carers use now? Well, they often use pain tools. Example are the Abbey Pain Scale, Pain Ad, or Dollar Plus. The problem is that there's no evidence that pain produces signs and behaviours that are different to other causes of distress. Pain doesn't cause unique signs and behaviours. And that means that if you use a pain tool in someone who, for example, is angry, it will show up as pain. And the risk is that a painkiller is then used to treat anger. So is there an alternative? Well, the key steps are, first of all, you need to document an individual's language of distress, to document their signs and behaviours of distress. You then compare this with their signs and behaviours when they're content, and you use the distress cues to see if there's a pattern or if you can spot the context of the distress. Then you sit down and you estimate the cause of the distress and use the individual's distress cues to monitor any interventions. Now, what we did find when we were validating this work is we found three important things. Firstly, each individual has a unique pattern of distress. They have their own distress language. Secondly, that pattern, that language, is the same whatever the cause of the distress. And thirdly, different carers pick up different signs and behaviours. So a team is better than an individual at listing an individual's distress cues. Now, the way we put all this together was in something called DisDAT, which stands for the Distress and Discomfort Assessment Tool. It documents an individual's language of distress. It also documents their signs and behaviours when they're content. So what's in it? Well, here's a section for facial appearance, for example. And what you'll see is that both distress and content cues are documented. And what you'll also notice is the words in both columns are exactly the same. And that's because DisDAT makes no assumptions about how an individual reacts. Some, for example, might laugh when they're happy, but others might laugh when they're frightened. There's also an option to add additional cues in your own words. And what DisDAT looks at is 9 different areas. So it really is quite fun. You don't have to fill all 9 areas, but the information is there if you need it. In addition, DisDAT includes a distress passport, which can be scanned and kept on e-records or sent to other carers who are seeing the individual for the first time. It also includes a checklist to help diagnose the cause of the distress and get you started. And lastly, the website contains some monitoring sheets that you can use to record the distress cues so that you can observe patterns and monitor interventions. Okay, that gives you a background of DisDAT. And now I'll ask Dorothy and Lynn to take us through a couple of case studies just to show how you can use DisDAT.
Hello, my name's Lynn Gibson. I was the manager of the physiotherapy service for people with learning disabilities in Northumberland. but now I'm retired. Okay, we're going to talk about Freddie. Freddie's a 47-year-old gentleman with Down syndrome and Alzheimer's type dementia. Freddie for many years lived at home with his father and was generally fit and well until he was diagnosed with his Alzheimer's type dementia. Dad became unwell himself and found he couldn't cope, so Freddie was admitted to the unit. Although having limited verbal skills, Freddie could still make himself understood to those that knowing him. His main method of communication was non-verbal, using gestures, sounds, and facial expressions. Very quickly, swallowing became an issue, resulting in an aspiration pneumonia, an admission to an acute hospital treated with IV antibiotics. The following much discussion with Freddie's father, his MDT, and other professionals, and which took place over a long period of time, eventually a PEG was inserted. Freddie was discharged back to the unit with the low profile PEG in situ, an established feeding regime. Enteral feeding regime was developed by a dietitian to titrate the food and minimize risk of refeeding syndrome. This was essential due to the period of long discussions, best interest meetings, because Freddie now had been without food for 6 weeks. Freddie initially responded well to his regime. However, on the third day, carers noted Freddie to be distressed during his feed. Following a team discussion, the decision was made to monitor Freddie's distress using DisDAT, which had been previously completed, and the monitoring forms, which can be found on the website. This is a graph depicting the results, which is really quite interesting. It was decided to monitor Freddie hourly. And as you can see, the graph shows that initially there was very little distress, but it climbed and climbed and originally peaked. It was interesting because this tied in beautifully with his feeding regime. And it showed that whilst the flushes didn't cause very much distress, the actual feed, which was being titrated, caused a maximum lot of distress. The staff noted this, depicted the pattern, and discussed within it the team, and it was decided that the issue was very probably gastric stasis. Because of this, Freddie was started on domperidone to try and alleviate some of the symptoms. Initially, as you can see on day one, the symptoms were very, very high. The cues of distress were very, very high. However, with the introduction of the drug, it then reduced and reduced. However, it was noted that some of these distress cues were not going away completely, so it was decided to increase the domperidone, which eventually alleviated all of the symptoms.
Hello, my name is Dorothy Matthews. I work as a Macmillan nurse for people with learning disabilities and mental health problems. I'm also one of the co-authors of DisDAT. Right, we're going to talk about a lady called Betty. Betty was a 60-year-old lady who had a mild to moderate learning disabilities. She did have excellent verbal skills and previously had lived in an independent supported living environment with 24-hour support. Betty did have rheumatoid arthritis and primary lymphedema to her lower limbs. At the point of admission onto the unit, Betty was being seen regularly at the local hospice for treatment interventions related to the lymphedema. Over time, in the ISL, Betty had developed some behaviours which became increasingly challenging. Care staff weren't sure what had precipitated these behaviours. She was also verbally abusive to her carers. So she came onto the unit for assessment with a query of non-compliance with the medication. She was well able and had capacity to manage and administer our own medication. But the carers felt that maybe the way that Betty was presenting meant that she had been not given our own medication. On admission, Betty appeared happy to be on the unit. She engaged very well with other people, with staff and with other individuals that lived on the unit at the time. From day one of admission, Betty strongly denied non-compliance with her medication and seemed always to want to get the message across that she had in fact always taken her medication. She was quite distressed at times that our care team suggested she wasn't taking her medication. But once settled onto the unit, despite medications being given by staff, it was quickly noted that Betty did have times in the day when she became less amenable and less engaging, and she seemed to not want to take part in activities around the unit or anything like that. Staff opinions were sought. We had a lot of discussions at the time, and we talked about the use of DisDAT. We hadn't really used DisDAT in someone who had such good verbal communication skills before, but we thought DisDAT would be very useful to gain more information in relation to Betty's distress. So we did discuss the use of DisDAT with Betty, who was agreeable to being observed and monitored. But this was very unusual for the team, because usually DisDAT had previously been used in people that had very limited verbal communication skills. So it was very different to have somebody that was really, really aware of being observed. But Betty was very agreeable and always amenable and engaging. DisDAT was completed to monitor Betty's distress, and we did this over a week period. The results were quite definite in indicating a pattern to Betty's distress. And what this highlighted instantly was that a current analgesic regime, the pain relieving medication she received for her rheumatoid arthritis, was not actually effective. Betty's previous analgesic medications had been prescribed 4 times a day. And the monitoring forms on the use of DisDAT indicated that Betty's distress increased prior to each dose of her analgesic medication, especially the early morning dose and the later evening dose. But still, the lunchtime dose and the tea time dose, there was definitely signs that she was becoming less engaging and a little bit more grumpy. So we'll discuss the findings from the DisDAT and from the monitoring sheets with the consultant. And we thought, you know, could this be related to her medication? Because obviously this lady was living with chronic pain and just be sort of becoming used to living with that pain. And was it, you know, was the behaviour a sign, a release from the pain that she was feeling, and the distress, and that was sort of came out in her behaviour. Betty's distress behaviours decreased when she was given the controlled release medication. So she had the new medication was given at 8 o'clock in the morning and at 8 o'clock at night. And the distress behaviours, so the grumpiness, the verbal abuse, all decreased, and she became far more engaging and far more interested in what was going on the unit. In fact, before she left the unit, she engaged very well in activity sessions, and she made for each of the staff little bookmarkers or a pom-pom with the occupational therapy in sessions, and she really enjoyed that. Betty was then discharged back to her ISL, and there have been no further issues with her behaviour, and she continued on the controlled release medication. So in summary, although initially DisDAT was developed for people with very limited verbal communication skills, we hope that these two case studies demonstrate that it can be effective across people with a wide range of both cognitive abilities and communication skills. And it's important to always remember that distress might sometimes be hidden, but it's never silent. It's always there if you look hard enough.
We hope it was useful to hear how DisDAT is put into practice with the cases of Freddie and Betty. But before we finish, let's just look at a few issues. We've seen how individuals can show a large number of signs and behaviours of distress. We found that individuals showed lots of distress cues, some showing 25 different cues or more, varying from facial appearance to vocalizations, to the way their eyes were moving or looked, habits and mannerisms, even movements of teeth and jaw and tongue. So there's lots of possibilities. But it seems likely that many individuals create even more cues. All individuals can show when they're content or they're distressed, but they also show signs and behaviours of early distress. So for example, one gentleman made good eye contact when he was well. He would follow you around a room. But when he was distressed, he would just stare straight in front of him, making no eye contact with anyone around him. But there was an intermediate stage before that, an early sign of distress, and that was when his eyes would appear quite normal, they weren't staring, but he'd lose the eye contact with those who are around him. And carers who know an individual well often pick up those early signs and act long before others notice. So let's summarise the key points. Well, firstly, pain, anger and fear all generate distress cues. However, there's really no evidence that pain generates unique signs and behaviours that are only produced by pain and no other cause of distress. Now that's very important because it questions the whole basis of using pain tools in individuals whose communication we find difficult to understand. Secondly, each individual appears to have a unique pattern of signs and behaviours. That's why you can't use a standardised form, and it's why each person's distress cues need to be documented. The other important issue is that it does seem that each individual generates the same distress cues no matter what the cause. And that's very important because it means you can't use a tool such as a pain tool. Documenting an individual's language of distress has several advantages. Firstly, it increases carer confidence in their observations, and that's important if they're to convince another health professional that there's a problem. Secondly, it enables the cause to be found. Sometimes the context makes the cause obvious, but other times the distress needs to be documented to see if there is a pattern, just as there was with Freddie and Betty in the case studies. And lastly, and importantly, documenting the distress cues allows you to monitor any interventions. It also allows you to share those observations with other carers. So, distress may be hidden, but it is never silent. You can download DisDAT for free from this website, along with some monitoring tools and our emails if you want to contact us. But you can certainly contact us at these emails, and we're happy to discuss any issues and share information and even video link with you if you wanted some more advice. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Claude. Thank you, Dorothy, and thank you, Lynn, for that really powerful talk. I'm sure you've all learned a lot. And if you have any questions, I can see lots of you are already putting questions in the Q&A box, but we will be going live to Claude and Dorothy and Amanda, hopefully, if we can make the connection in a minute. But before we do that, let me give Amanda the very final word here.
I think the person with a learning disability, we know our own bodies and we know when we're not feeling well, and we should be listened to just because we've got a learning disability. We're not stupid, we're not idiots. I know when I really don't feel well, and you should believe us. because that one time you don't believe that there's something seriously wrong, something seriously could really happen to that person. I know it's difficult if somebody has communication problems and they can't talk properly. I understand this is more difficult. If somebody has a communication problem, then the person who is looking after them is the best person for them to get advice from, because they know if there's something wrong and if they change their behaviour from normal.
Oh, thank you to all the speakers. Thank you, Amanda, in particular for that final comment. I'm not quite sure why we even bothered getting Claude in. You see, summed it all up. But thank you. It's been really, really illuminating. But we do have some time now for questions. So the first person I'm going to connect with is Amanda. Now, unfortunately, I haven't been able to connect with her on video, but I've got Amanda on the phone. So hopefully, I hope this is going to work. I'm going to ask her the first question, which is, Amanda, you said that when the doctors, when you told the doctor what was wrong, then they didn't believe you. And I'm just wondering what kind of tips or advice you have for other people to whom that now happens. So if somebody, you know, if you were to go to the doctor again now and say something and he didn't believe you, what would you do now?
Now I wouldn't take any chances, and I would go straight to accident and emergency, even if I would have to wait for a long time. And it's scary at the moment because of what's happening, but at least I would get seen and get the proper treatment, because they're always saying that going to the hospital is not all about corona, and there could be something seriously wrong.
Yeah, that's a really important point, that you should really take things seriously, you know, and get things checked out, don't we? So thank you, Amanda. I think your talk was so helpful. I'm just going to go over now to the other speakers, because there are lots of questions have come for them as well. But thank you so much for that.
You're welcome.
So I'm just going to hand over now to Louise, who has been monitoring all the questions in the Q&A box that have come in for Claude and Dorothy about DisDAT.
So I've been looking at some of the questions coming through. So the themes that are coming through are around questions around who else could the DisDAT be used for? So some of the questions are around, is this transferable to people with dementia or younger people or adults only? And that's one of the questions. So I don't know who wants to answer that, Claude or Dorothy?
Dorothy, do you want to start?
Yeah. We do know that DisDAT is being used in the children's and people's services at St Oswald's Hospice very successfully and over many years. It's also been successfully used in dementia services, and we do see it, although initially developed for people with a learning disability and very limited verbal skills, we do see it as being a very transferable tool in terms of its use at any point where people's communication does become limited due to illness, progression of illness, or anything similar to that.
Yeah, I would support that. I mean, it hasn't been validated in children and young people. And when I talk about children, we're not talking here about neonates and babies, but certainly older children and young people, it seems to be working very well. It does need to be validated. So there's anybody out there who's working with children and young people and they want to validate it, get in touch with us. We have protocols for doing it, for doing the study. So it would be, but certainly the children's hospice find it very helpful. I think the issue with dementia care is that still in dementia care, people are still relying a lot on pain tools, and it's causing problems in dementia care because people are tending to jump towards using analgesics, and sometimes very strong analgesics, to manage the distress. And what's nice about DisDAT, it makes no assumptions about the cause. It should be transferable because DisDAT is communication specific, it's not diagnosis specific. So it should be eminently suitable for transferring across. And of course, a lot of the folks we validated on, while they had learning disabilities, a number of them had an Alzheimer's type dementia. So actually we did validate it effectively in dementia care.
Okay, so looking at some of the other questions that are coming in, there's some themes coming in around, are there plans to promote the use of the DisDAT tool within some of the behavioural support services? And, you know, equally linked to that around, would it be useful part of positive behavioural support plans?
Yes, I think so. And when DisDAT was initially developed and we looked towards developing the monitoring sheets that we have, and on the website, there's currently three different types of monitoring sheets, and certainly behaviour services were involved in developing the monitoring sheets at that point and have used the DisDAT tool. It's been rolled out across so many services that across the country and into other countries as well. DisDAT's been translated into Danish, Norwegian, and obviously we're not sure kind of what services are included in different organisations, but yes, certainly behaviour support services have used DisDAT, yes.
I mean, one of the questions was asking about, I think mentioned about, and there are different pain tools which are used in children. It's very interesting about pain tools in individuals where communication is an issue. There is one pain tool that's been validated in non-pain distress, and that was a study, in fact, that we did, and we were comparing it with DisDAT. And what it showed is that that particular pain tool, which was PAINAD, pain in Alzheimer's disease, had a very high number of false positives. In other words, essentially pain tools are just distress tools. The difficulty about them is that they basically use a very limited number of issues in when they are measuring pain tools, whereas DisDAT allows you to document whatever an individual is expressing. And the other thing is, of course, with DisDAT, you're comparing distress cues with content cues, and that's really important. Even in folks who are able to communicate, like Amanda, you know, to be able to say, look, this is the way I am when I'm content, and this is the way I am now. And it's sad in a way, but I know in terms of doctors and maybe other healthcare professionals, we love bits of paper. If you can show us a bit of paper that says, look, this is this and this is me now, and I am not content, you know, somehow health professionals go, oh, right, okay, well, that's important. I'll believe it now. It's wrong. It shouldn't be that way, but it is a fact.
And also, can you just add to that, Claude, the importance of the context of the behaviour, the context, the situation in which the behaviour is occurring. And just quickly to say, I was involved with a gentleman with an advanced malignancy and visited very frequently, lived in a small group home. And one day I got a call from the carers to say that he'd become more increasingly distressed. We used DisDAT all of the time and the monitoring sheets, and they felt he may need an increase in his analgesic, in his morphine. He had ongoing problems with constipation despite our best efforts. We really couldn't kind of get that adequately sorted for him. But just to kind of summarise, when I visited, he was quite distressed, but carer said he had been more distressed over the previous 2 days, 2.5 days. And when I sat down with the carers, talked about the monitoring sheets, talked about, you know, how he had been, looked at everything, collated everything, there was nothing kind of physically that was causing this distress. And the outcome was that the care home had actually had an engineer in for 2 days, 2.5 days, installing an all singing, all dancing bath for him. But that was actually the cause of his whole distress. And had we not looked at the context in that situation, we might have ended up increasing analgesic unnecessarily.
Can I just say, I'll come in here, because I always find the DisDAT just fascinating. And you know, Claude, I've done some teaching on this, and I'm also always struck by, you know, palliative care staff in particular who are not used to working with people with learning disabilities, hear about this tool and think, actually, this makes sense for everyone. And when you think about it, you know, there are ways in which I know that a member of my family is not quite right, because I can see really subtle changes. The foot goes, or they just take slightly longer to answer a question, you know, and I think, oh, they're cross, and somebody else might not notice that. So I think there's probably a wider use for it. And so the question I'm going to ask connected with that is, now, particularly if people can't speak, do you think there's a place for this tool for people at the very end of life, you know, when people are semi-conscious or unconscious? I don't know. Have you thought about whether there's relevance there?
Yeah, I mean, Dorothy and Lynn and I have talked about this. I have to say, at the beginning, I thought, it had crossed my mind, and I thought, no, we could use it for this. But the more we think about it, and Dorothy and Lynn both saying, well, I don't know why you think that, Claude, it should be possible. And we have a protocol ready to go if somebody wants to do the research. I'm trying to get some palliative care people to do it. And the beauty about it is, of course, you could be validating it with the patient's consent while they're still able to talk to you. So ethically, it would not be an issue. And then it's quite likely that in our experience, a lot of signs and behaviors of distress would continue on. And it's while it's important to be able to pick up distress in the very last hours and days of life, it's just as important to pick up the lack of any distress. And to reassure people that things are actually okay and this individual is not being distressed. So yes, I think it is possible, but the work hasn't been done yet.
And also, can you just sort of clarify, because quite a lot of things I can see in the Q&A box are to do around whether it should be linked with hospital passports. And, you know, those of you up listening to this webinar who are not used to that concept, a hospital passport is a sort of really simple, quite short document that shows, you know, people's the important information about somebody, particularly with a learning disability in hospital, things you like, things you don't like, people to contact, you know, ways I communicate, those kind of things. Do you think that this that could be linked to that?
Yes, I do, certainly. It is linked up north to that, and quite a lot of areas. DisDAT's completed alongside the hospital passport, or alongside care plans for that person. So it sometimes forms a part of a package for the person, if you like, when they're transferred to acute care or any other service, anything that's personalised to them, DisDAT becomes part of that, yes, because in actual fact, it is about identifying and documenting the person's language. So yeah, it would, you know, and it's kind of an advocate in itself to tell people that, you know, we need to listen with more than our ears. People that are non-verbal do have a lot to say. We just need to listen differently to that.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And I think that it's that business of increasing carer confidence. We're not suggesting that carers, you know, are not assertive, but it's just that they pick up these cues so instinctively. they then find it hard to translate it in words and say, look, this is why I feel the way I am, that he or she is not right. And suddenly it's on a piece of paper. But it also, it actually trains carers to say to exactly what Dorothy is saying, to actually pick up these cues. A good example is that Lynn, being a physiotherapist, would always pick up posture and tone. For me, I mean, it went right over my head. I didn't pick up those things at all. But suddenly when somebody else is picking it up, you go, oh, do you know what? I didn't notice that. Yes. So it's a wonderful training aid as much as a teaching aid and a communication aid.
That's great. And just finally, before we have to finish this Q&A, a few two more short questions. The first one is somebody asking how long ago this was developed. Now, I know that you talked to me about this when I first met you about 20 years ago. Is that right? And connected with that, has things changed in the past 20 years with the DisDAT? You know, what have you learned really in 20 years of using it?
Changed greatly, hasn't it, Claude? We now want a version 21, and the initial versions of DisDAT actually had a booklet of definitions that were attached to the tool to help you sort of understand the abbreviations and things in the tool. And part of that was a recording, wasn't it, Claude, of sounds, pitch and tone and things like that. So it's developed, it's evolved over the years, and a lot of that evolvement has been with advice and comments from people who've actually used the tool, and we've used the comments and the advice to increase the tool to make it a more usable, workable document.
Yeah, and one of those things is that we keep getting asked, is there an e-record version of DisDAT? Believe me, over the last 10 years, we've tried repeatedly. And when you create an E version of DisDAT, it completely alters the tool. The other big problem is that the E record, the E DisDAT, we know will become the ownership of whatever organization is holding it. And that goes right against a fundamental philosophy of DisDAT, that it belongs to the individual person and their carers. So we've stuck with a paper version. However, you can always scan the e-passport, and that can be put on the e-record. And the monitoring tools, we're going to create an e-version of the monitoring tools at some point, but they're not copyright, and anybody is very welcome to create their own monitoring tools in an e-version if they want. And of course, the monitoring tool is what you use from day to day to monitor some interventions and so on, and to pick up patterns. But providing the DisDAT is your baseline is what kicks off. And you were saying earlier about getting confidence. A lot of individuals now have DisDAT completed as a baseline. It is possible to do it in an acute situation. I have completed a DisDAT in hospital by phoning the carers over a 15-20 minute phone conversation, and we were actually able to complete DisDAT really fairly well, and that was very helpful for the team in the hospital. But ideally you do it as a baseline.
Thank you very much, Claude and Dorothy, and also Amanda on the phone. I mean, I'm afraid that's all we've got time for, but it's been so fascinating, and I'm sure it's been very helpful for lots of people. So those of you who had, you know, struggling to log on, or you might have missed some bits because your computer froze, or actually our computer froze, don't worry, it's all going to be on YouTube, hopefully without all these hitches. So just wait for that. So do keep the conversations going. I just have a few final announcements to make before we finish this webinar. If you would like to receive a certificate of attendance, then please email your full name to info@pcpld.org. And it would actually really also help us if you could then give us a donation, however small, you know, whether you ask for a certificate or not. We're a small charity. We have no source of income other than donations. We are very grateful that we have received a couple of grants recently, and you can see those logos here, which has helped us to organize this webinar series. I want to say a huge thank you to today's speakers. Thank you to Amanda Cresswell, Claud Regnard, Dorothy Matthews and Lynn Gibson for what's been a fascinating and illuminating webinar. Next month's webinar is also going to be really interesting. Not all deaths are expected or planned for, and sometimes staff and families are taken by surprise or by shock. So how can learning disability services in particular prepare for the unexpected? And we will hear several real life stories, and Professor Jane Bernal, who's done some research around this, will share her learning with us. And finally, can I just alert you to the new podcast series that we have just started last month. So that's all very exciting. That's myself and Gemma Allen, the chair of our network, in conversation also with a group of people with learning disabilities. And here are the examples of the first two episodes. So, as I say, thank you very much for listening. And as promised, before we finish, we are going to just listen to some uplifting voices, I think. Is it a sing-out choir? I always think it's really nice to finish with something that reminds us who, you know, who we are working with, who are we living with, who are, what, you know, who matters really in life. So thank you to the sing-out choir for allowing us to share this video with all of you.
Hey Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song and make it better. Remember to enter into your heart, then you can start to make it.
Oh, thank you to the sing-out choir. Actually, I can see all the speakers, you can't, but all of us were sitting here at our desk doing this. Thank you very much. And we hope to see you again on the 8th of December for our next webinar. Thank you.